How would you like to gain more understanding and confidence in marketing? Have monthly updates, inspiration, and accountability? How about working with a marketing consultant who will keep you on track? Well, that's what the Cougar Academy is. The Cougar Academy are monthly masterclasses talking about various subjects, activities, and techniques with regards to marketing. You meet online so we don't have to meet face to face. You don't have to travel anywhere. Just turn on your computer and we're good to go. If this sounds like something for you, check out www.cougaracademy.co.uk. Okay, so today I'd like to welcome Samantha Howard from KeyTech. We're going to be talking about GDPR from an IT perspective. And Samantha is, we met at the Chamber of Commerce women's event, didn't we?
We did, yes.
We were sat on the same table, and there was two ladies on the same table from different companies who were talking about GDPR and running workshops, mm-hmm. and you were one of them.
Yeah.
And Jane Sanderson-Brown was another person, and I've interviewed Jane already about mm-hmm. GDPR from an HR perspective,
yeah.
Which was a great podcast. It lasted for about 45 minutes. We had fun. So today I'm here with you, Samantha. So tell me more about yourself, your role in KeyTech, and what KeyTech is.
Okay. So I am an account manager at KeyTech, and my role is to look after the businesses that we manage in terms of making sure that they've got everything they need for the business, the software, the managed services, what they need in terms of making them more efficient, more productive, and things that come to market that we think is technology that would enable them to work better, faster, harder, smarter.
Okay,
that is great. What we do for them.
Yeah.
So we make sure that we're delivering what they need. And then the other side of the coin is that when their businesses are operating day to day, that we manage those services. We do the help desk services. We monitor and manage all their key hardware, or the firewalls, or the mm-hmm. security, etc. So we do two things. We work with them in the business to help them be productive and be up and function as they should do, and we help them work on the business in terms of technologies that we think are going to enable them to get where they need to be for their journey.
Fabulous. So it's all things IT.
All things IT and training as well. We do lots of training for people to help them. So they get technologies in like Office 365, Microsoft Suite is huge. They might be using 3% of it.
Yeah.
But they could actually be using all of it to enable them to be more productive. So we do a lot of things in the background besides the technology. We do the enablement of employees as well.
Brilliant, because a lot of IT companies I know just tend to put that stuff
in
place.
Throw it in and say, see you later.
Yeah. And you know,
we don't do that.
Yeah, that a lot of people do. So is that your differentiator for
KeyTech?
What would you say the other differentiator is?
A big one is we're going for 25 years, and a lot of our key staff and a lot of our key technical people have been here that length of time. So
okay.
They've seen a lot of change, but we do a lot. It's been going for a long time. We are quite good at partnerships with vendors. So VMware, Microsoft, Dell, Veeam, the platforms for security that we're using with Checkpoint, which are the market leaders.
Mm-hmm.
So because we've been in there from the start as early adopters, we get technologies given to us to try, beta test, to understand what it looks like in the marketplace, mm-hmm. how we would use that. So we get the benefit of being able to pass all that consultancy on and also have those vendors come into customers with us and say, look, this is what it looks like, this is what we're doing, this is how it's going to work,
yeah.
This is how it would work for you. So it's not just us, it's our partners as well. But we also have a really good backbone of consultancy, so we can go into a customer with no axe to grind on a brand or a partner in particular. We can give them what they need rather than what we sell and shoehorn them in,
which is
a difference, yeah, because
yeah.
some people say, yeah, we need one of these, and it's because that's what they sell, not what the customer
yeah.
needs. So we spend a lot of time up front on consultancy, and all the testimonials on our website will say the due diligence that we do in understanding what the customer's doing, why they're doing, what it means to them,
mm-hmm.
and then delivering them the ability to achieve that is what we are very good at,
yeah.
rather than saying, well, you want a new server, here you go, because that might not be what they need. What they're trying to do is be more productive or have more storage.
Yeah.
So we understand what they want, and then we deliver it. And then on the back of that, we can also look after it for them.
Which is good.
Yeah.
So you don't just dump them in
Absolutely, and leave them to their own devices.
No.
And we work with a lot of companies who have an IT department, and we're there not to, not they don't see us and go, oh my God, they're going to take my job. We go, thank goodness for that. I can't manage all of this on my own. Yeah. I need to be able to give that to somebody else and get on with the stuff that I really need to make a difference. So, yeah.
Well, I actually did a video about wants and needs and how a lot of business owners and marketing managers sell the need to the customer. Mm-hmm. Well, in actual fact, they need to sell what the customer wants.
Yeah.
They might need certain things, but they might not know that they need that.
Exactly.
So it's about talking them through and saying, you know, this is where we are. This is what we believe that you need. I know that you want X, Y, and Z, but that's not going to give you what you need for the business to grow. So, which is great.
And that's the due diligence part of what we do, understanding why they're doing it, what they're doing it for, what it means to them, and where they need to be by a particular time. And then we help them achieve that with whatever it is that they need to do that.
Okay. So what is GDPR?
GDPR, well, it's a positive change, I would say.
Good. Some people are actually petrified of it.
We go to a lot of events, and I've been to a couple where there's a lot of scaremongering about you've got to have it done by this day, so there's massive fines, and you know they're going to come around with the TV detective on style on the day after it goes live to catch everybody out. What GDPR is, it's about time. It's about managing data and data visibility, because when the current Data Protection Act came in, when email was not like it is now.
Nope.
The proliferation of you having data in 16 different social media platforms being sold to the way that we're sold to now, it was very, very different landscape. And now what GDPR is going to be a platform where everybody, not just some companies, every business needs to comply to a simple set of rules around data governance, data management, and taking care of personal data.
Mm-hmm.
And that affects us as individuals in our own lives at home and also as business people.
Yeah. I think the compliance part of the GDPR, a lot of people are talking about compliance, but compliance means that, you know, you're going to pass an exam, certain way of doing it. But unfortunately, GDPR isn't. I don't think it's just my perspective and my opinion. I don't think you can be compliant. They've given us guidelines.
That's
they haven't
right.
given us rules. Mm-hmm. So compliance is about, you know, nobody's going to get a certificate saying that you're GDPR compliant. We will obviously be checked out and made sure that, you know, we're following the rules and the 12 steps that the ICO have given us. But compliance for me is a little bit...
It's subject to interpretation
massively,
which is a problem in some ways. There's a lot of grey areas. But the basic understanding of the due diligence that you should deliver as an employer and the due diligence you should deliver as a company that's marketing or trying to navigate the landscape of what is personal data, what's private data, business to consumer, how data's stored if you're an employee. There's so many different areas where your name, your address, your phone number, your national insurance number, your bank details, your medical records are out there in the world. Depending on what you do with that data and how you are as a business, depends on what compliance, in inverted commas, you need to follow.
Yeah.
And that's why there's been a lot of scaremongering with some companies saying everybody has to do X by Y.
Yeah.
There are some things that you do need to have done by then, but it's a bit of a cliche to use the word journey, but the compliance is a journey. You'll start it now, and when it doesn't finish on the 25th of May, it will never end. It's going to be, and there will be other laws that come out, and there will be updates and refinements as our world changes. Because, you know, who'd heard of Google 10 years ago, 12 years ago?
Yeah.
There'll be another one of those coming along. So it's an organic thing, but you cannot ignore it. You do have to be aware of it, and being unaware is where you will come a cropper if you have a breach.
Certainly. And I think there's two things there. I've had a number of people contact me and say, you know, this GDPR thing, what can I do to get around it? I don't want to have to do it. And I'm like, hang on. What I want to say is, do you remember when Facebook turned around to people and said, if you're using your profile as a business, we're going to turn you off.
Mm.
And everybody was like, they can't do that. Mm. You can't turn my profile off. It's my profile, da, da, da. And then people were starting to wake up.
Mm.
You know, I remember a photographer in the news, local to where I was at the time, and he lost his entire business. He lost all his clients, all the data that was in there because they turned it off.
Mm.
Facebook told him that he was going to turn it off, but he just didn't believe them.
Yeah.
And this is the thing with GDPR, is a lot of people think, well, actually, it doesn't apply to me. It actually applies to everybody. It doesn't matter what size your business is.
Exactly.
Even if you're a one-man, one-woman band, it applies to everybody.
Mm.
And there isn't a way of sort of getting around the back and not being able to do a privacy policy or terms of business, you know, especially because we're talking about it from marketing website point of view. So you can't really get around it. You've got to do it. And it isn't a case of, you know, another question I'm asked is, well, can I just take somebody else's privacy policy? I'm like, yeah, you can. But there's two things to that. Google will get rid of you because they're potentially blacklisted because you've taken somebody else's copy. And the other thing is that if somebody turns around to you and says, well, this, you know, is this correct? Or I don't believe that what you're saying is right. And it's based on another business's terms or privacy policy or cookie policy, how are you going to feel about that? You know, so it isn't a copy and paste. It isn't a, you know, what can I take and what can I not do? So we've got to actually approach this as a fresh start. You know, as you said, it's having a look at the business and saying, right, where do we start? You know, what can you get rid of? It's like a spring clean to me.
It is, yeah.
And the second thing that I wanted to just pick up on, because you mentioned that there are a certain things that we have to do by the 25th. Could you just talk about what they are from KeyTech's point of view?
Yeah, so from a business point of view with the businesses we talk to, is having an understanding of what data you hold, where it is, who uses it, who's got access to it, what the permissions are you happy that that is what it should be like.
So essentially, by the 25th, we need to have the audit of our business done.
You should have a pretty good idea of what you've got, where it is, why you've got it, what you're using it for, and who's got access to it. That is the basis of GDPR, isn't it? It is that. And then from that becomes what you do with your HR, how you contact your customers and market them, and how you protect your business and your business data, which is the IT
as well as finance
section of it.
Yeah, as well as finance, because we need to think of finance. You know, where are your, you know, if you use Xero, Sage or whatever other platform that you do accounts in, how much data is in there as well? Some people don't realise that it's across the board.
It is data. Yeah. Data in capital letters, wherever that resides.
Yeah.
And we have, there's quite a few HR companies will go out and do a data audit, and we always say, who are you asking and how do they know where the data is? Because from an IT point of view, we have customers and we go into businesses when they're new to us who we don't normally deal with, and they'll tell us where the data is, and we'll just say, oh, what's on that desktop over there? And they'll go, I have absolutely no idea. And we go, exactly. You could have two people who saved something months ago. They don't even, they see it every day, but they don't actually see it. They don't realise what it is, and it's on the desktop.
Subconscious, isn't
it's
it?
It's just in there. Yeah. And that could be, that is personal data. So that desktop gets stolen or you get a virus on it. That data's gone. You've got no idea what's out there. You haven't got a clue.
Yeah.
So we use tools. There are tools out there that you can deploy that will tell you where your data is. And you've got an absolutely black and white copy of that is what I've got, not what I think we've got.
Okay, that's
or
interesting.
Or what such a body's got, or did we do that? Or, and it's like the permissions. We have people who were given permission to access a file a couple of years ago for a one-off. The permissions are still in place. That person shouldn't have access. They might have even left the business, but it's still open.
Wow.
Anybody
okay.
could get onto that in the business if you're
that's
in a thing. So it's things like that.
Yeah.
And you don't get that by having a conversation with somebody in HR going, who's got what have you got? You can't see that always.
Yeah.
So
we're skipping ahead in terms of, I was going to ask you about technology. So you've said that there's a piece of technology that could find
there's
out all
there's lots
of
software you can use, different ways you can use it.
Okay, so what would we type into Google to find that kind of thing?
Well, you can do things through Active Directory, which would be within your environment, or you can look at something that we use a lot of called Rapid Fire Tools that you can buy that go onto a network that run audits. There's lots of different ways you can find information, but what they will give you is an absolute, undisputed view of, like a negative of your business, of where the data is, who's got permissions to it, where it's at, how much data there is, in what pockets of places, whether it's
perfect.
On your, as long as it's on your network. Yeah. And if you've got things that aren't on your network, you can then go do an audit of devices that people might have that are outside your network. So salespeople, people who work from home, people that aren't always coming into the building and logging onto your network. There's easy ways of doing that as well, so you would have an understanding of exactly what you've got, where it is, and what kind of data it is.
Perfect. So what do you think technology's role is when it comes to GDPR?
Well, we would always say that GDPR is not an IT problem. It's a top-down, policy-driven issue. But IT plays a part in, there's four different places, really, on the 12 sets of GDPR where we would say that the IT has a role, has a place, and there are things along the lines of,
because there's 12 steps, isn't there?
Yeah, the 12 steps of GDPR, in terms of understanding what that looks like, you're looking at things to do with data breaches. Mm-hmm. So you're looking at the information that you hold, which we've just been talking about. What yep. data have you got and where is it? The second thing is your privacy information and communicating your privacy information. That can be things around things like this on your website, mm-hmm. Data capture, that sort of mm-hmm. thing. You've also got the data breaches part and the data protection by design, which is the tools and the systems you put in place to protect yourself if you had a breach, to either detect a breach has happened mm-hmm. or if something happened to your business, you've got some kind of business continuity in place that you can recover.
Yeah. So this is like we're talking about backup.
Backup and business continuity. Yeah. A backup and disaster recovery are not the same thing. And this is an issue that's out there in the marketplace. Okay. So if you have a backup, you can take it off site and stick it in your pen drive or put it in your handbag. Mm-hmm. But say you had an issue in your business and you want to use that backup to run your business, what are you going to do? Where are you going to put that stick? Yeah. What's it going to go on?
Yeah.
Have you ever tested it? How on earth are you going to run your business mm-hmm. off a USB stick? And it's the same with backup if you're backing up the software in the cloud, which is great. If you can't access that data straight away without having to rebuild a machine and then copy the data back over, mm-hmm. you haven't got business continuity. You've got downtime, haven't you?
Yeah.
So business continuity is a system whereby you can work on-site or off-site using your live data.
Yeah.
So if something happened, you'd have a blip of a short, very short period, talking minutes rather than hours or mm-hmm. days, and then you can carry on working.
Yeah, because long gone are the days where you're carrying a stick wrapped around your neck.
You'd be amazed.
No, I'm not amazed. I completely, yeah. I see that all the time, yeah. actually. Lots of people do have sticks. I've got sticks, you know. Mm.
And there's nothing wrong with that.
No.
People need to use them.
Yeah, but I know people who have their business on yeah. a stick. Mm. You know, it's a large stick and you just think, what happens? Mm. What happens if that goes? Because you hear all of this stuff in the news, don't you, about MPs and leaving a laptop or yeah. a bag on, yeah. You know, a train or yeah. a coach or mm-hmm. in a car, taxi or whatever. And, you know, and then somebody has gained access to the whole mm. of...
Yeah.
whole of somebody's business and takes over and ransomware and
that's
hacking
right, yeah.
in.
And there's so many different ways that, yeah. that things can come in. So you're looking at things like having a policy. So when we talk about IT and GDPR, it being policy driven, a business would have a cybersecurity policy that might state, if you have a device, a portable device that you use for work, you shall not leave it. And if you do leave it, it will be encrypted in the business level policy. So mm-hmm. have all their software or their laptops or the tablets, whatever they're using, with encryption on there.
Yeah.
So the encryption will allow, if someone takes your laptop, they can't boot it without the encryption code. If they take your hard drive out, they can't get onto the hard drive without the encryption code. And that might be something you don't have now, but you choose to implement for GDPR mm-hmm. because you want to protect your data. There's other things like bring your own device. There's a world of pain around that. So if it's yeah. your laptop, but you work for me, and I say to you, this is my policy, you need to go and do that, and you say, well, I don't want to do that, mm-hmm. then we've got a problem.
Yes.
Currently, I might not even think about it.
Yeah.
I might not think about your kid sticking a USB in there or downloading games and infecting yeah. that laptop with things. You then come into my network and plug into my network, and all your infection is all over my system. So it's a policy, again, that would be policy, mm-hmm. what you can and you can't do, what you're happy with and what you don't want to happen anymore.
Yeah.
And that's policy driven from the top down.
Yeah.
And then IT comes in with implementing what the policies are going to be.
Yeah. So that's more from if you've got associates in the business or freelancers in the business, people who use their own device
yeah,
technology.
Yeah, some people want to use a better laptop than the business would give them because that's what yep. they like and they want to do that. And some businesses say, yeah, fine, you want to buy your own laptop. That's great for me. Off you go. But yeah. nowadays you might be thinking, hang on a minute.
Mm, yeah.
I haven't thought about that. It's a massive area for infecting your business. So you need to have yeah. a policy to make a decision on what you choose to do.
Yes. Okay.
And again, so it's the policy is the driver of what happens. The IT part is implementing what the policy is going to be. So you need to have encryption. You need to have something that tells me that your antivirus is up to date. Mm-hmm. You're not allowed to use this type of antivirus. It's not good enough. It's got to be one of these three. You know, whatever your policy yeah. is, depends on your business size. But Windows updates, do you regularly allow Windows updates on your machine? Because if you don't, there's an issue there with patching mm-hmm. and infections can come in. So I might insist that you do Windows updates, but we know a lot of people go, oh, I'm shutting up at 5 o'clock. There's a yeah. Windows update. I'm not hanging around for that. And you might be 20 patches behind, which is a problem
yeah.
because you come into my network and you plug into my system and you infect my business. So it's things like that that need to be considered.
Yeah.
Like, are you going to have all that done by the 25th of May if you've not even thought about them? Highly unlikely. Can you prove you started to do something about it and it's part of your policy journey?
Yeah.
Then fine, and you are aware of it, and they're the things that you should have in place now.
Mm.
You might not have done anything about it yet, but you are thinking about and starting to put together your policy if you haven't already done so.
So you mentioned data by design. I think it's number 10 on just looking at the 12 steps the ICO have given the world to stick to. So data by design or data protection by design, what does that actually mean? Because a lot of people say that, but, you know, I've been in an audience where I'm not sure what it means. I've been in an audience where the person who's been asked that question doesn't really know what it means. So can you expand on that?
So data by design and data protection impact, it's along the lines of, if you have issues and you have breaches, as far as we're concerned, it's sort of quite sensible. It's understanding how your business runs at the minute. If you know where your data is and you're protecting it, if something happened with your data, what would the impact be? Do you have a policy around it? It's all about policy. It's all about understanding your policy and your protection. So if you know that your data is backed up and managed and you've got a firewall that's got all the right security policies on there, that your people have had cybersecurity training, you've got a cyber policy that they all agree with, you're regularly checking up that people know what they're doing and they're empowered to be your first line of defence, that you've got conversations you've had with any third parties that you're using to make sure that they are compliant.
So 365 and
so it could be your data centre, it could be someone who's selling your data, it could be the people who manage your antivirus, anybody that you're in business with that is part of a chain that you've made sure you've done your due diligence to make sure that they're compliant as well. And that's basically what it is, that you've got a plan and you understand where you fit into that plan and how your business is covered in all areas, whether that's locking your cabinets if you've got your HR on paper, you know, just basic simple.
Or even passwords on paper.
Passwords.
Yeah.
Wi-Fi passwords, you know, simple basic things like how many people have on their cyber policy that their employees cannot log on to a Wi-Fi network without a password on any company property or any property that is there only using for company business. Loads of businesses don't have that.
And they should.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay.
So it's those sorts of things that data by design is making sure you have a system and policies in place that protect you. Having a policy is not the same as having something that protects you.
Exactly.
You can write it on a piece of paper, but you've got to implement it. And that's where the IT part comes in. It's implementing the changes that you're going to make.
And finding the right software.
Yeah, enforcing the changes to make sure that instead of it being a nice thing to have and we really should get around to doing that, that you've actually done something about it.
So how do we assess our business data well? How do we... you know, we've talked about doing an audit, but how do we make sure that we don't miss anything? You know, I suppose we use one of those pieces of software that you mentioned before to go out and see what permissions everything has, who's got access to what. Is there, you know, a set way of making sure we can assess what we've got?
The simplest one is with this data by design is, can you prove you can protect your data? Can you prove you can get it back? Do you do any tests on your business continuity and your backup? When's the last time you did a full disaster recovery backup? And do you know you can protect your data wherever it is, on a laptop, on a phone, on a server? So that's one thing, and you can do that quite easy. That's a yes and no. Have you got that or have you not? So that's one part of it. The second part is understanding the current state of where your information is, and you can only do that by having somebody in the business who knows the ins and outs of absolutely everything to sit down and go through everything with you, or paying a company to come in and do a full audit, or doing a mixture of the two things of understanding where your data is and also what kind of data that you've got.
Yes.
Which is the second part of it, isn't it? So you can have I've got all this data, and then you need to segment it into, what have I got?
Is it sensitive? Is it just...
Why have I got it? So if you've done things where you do the marketing part of it, so you know more than me, if you've got data that you've bought that has a sell-by date, but you still got it in your network, you shouldn't have that anymore.
No.
That, you know, you should be cleaning that up and tidying up to get down to essential data.
Yeah.
Your employees, HR, finance, you know, the business.
I think it's quite...
data, you know, and anything that you've got on things that you've got that you might have, I don't know if you take credit card payments, you know, things like that, and code of... of things from years ago or things that you need to keep genuinely, which is fine because you can keep things. If you've got a legitimate business reason to keep them, that's fine. But where is it and who's got access to it? And it is hard because a smaller business will probably have to answer that in 5 minutes if there's only three people and they're all working off a laptop. Mm-hmm. That's pretty straightforward. But if you've got a business that's got 3,000 employees and six different sites, it becomes a bigger issue. And that's where tools come in.
Yeah.
And if you're somewhere in between, you might be able to do a little bit through some of the software that you've got already. Then if you've got CRMs that are managed, you'll be able to have some of your data will be in that. And you'll have to speak to them to say, what is your policy on GDPR in terms of how you look after my data if it's on a hosted portal? If it's on your own infrastructure, then that comes down to, have you protected it? Can you get it back? And is it manageable? So it all really depends on your size of your business and your attitude to risk as well, because some people are going, oh, I'll be fine, I've kind of got an idea, or whether you want to be forensic about it, in which case you run a tool.
Yeah. I think everything that you've talked about is eye-opening, number one, but also it can be scary for smaller businesses as well.
Yeah, and
I think that if you just take a step back and look at it as if to say, I'm just going to know more about my business, I'm going to understand it at a completely different level, and say, God, I've still got this thing, and I've had it since 2012. I actually don't need it, and it's actually going against the grain, isn't it? We're humans are hoarders, aren't they?
Yeah.
They like to keep everything to make sure that they've got it and it's safe and all of that kind of thing. And it makes people feel uncomfortable because they've got to do something that they don't really want to do. We just touched on breaches slightly, and we know that the ICO have asked us to, if we have a data breach, we've got to tell them within 72 hours.
Mm-hmm.
How will we know if we've got a breach? Obviously, if we leave a stick on a train or something, or a bag in a laptop or whatever, you know, we know that we've done that. Is it as small as those kind of things, or is it as big as, you know?
Data is one of those strange things, so... Normally, if you were burgled and you had your data, you had something stolen in your house, they took your television, you'd have a television-shaped hole, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
With data, someone can take your data and your data's still
know.
There.
Yeah.
You wouldn't know.
You would never know. Yeah.
So you've got that as one sort of breach. Another breach would be if you get a virus.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you're more likely to get a virus than anything else, to be honest, because of the number of attacks that are coming through every single day.
And the emails that people get. Yeah, well, the emails, just click on something and it will just pop something in.
So... That is the biggest attack vector, really, is people. People make mistakes and people are always happy. You always get someone in a business who'll click on anything, no matter how many times you tell them.
Yeah.
So that is where you're going to get the most obvious breach, because you'll get the skull and crossbones will come up and it'll be, oh, my goodness me, all hell's just broken loose. What do I do now? You'll have to report that and the ICL will decide whether they come and you have a visit or a phone call or however they're going to do it. Nobody quite knows yet what that's going to look like. But they will say to you, can you talk me through what you do in a breach? Can you talk me through the training that person may have had regarding what they shouldn't be clicking on? What's your business continuity plan? What's your return to operation? Your recovery time policy? What's your disaster recovery test? They're going to ask you those sorts of questions.
Yeah.
So as a business owner, you can't go, I've no idea what you're talking about.
Yeah.
You need to say, well, what we're doing at the minute is this, or we're planning to do that, and I've put this in place now, or this is it. This is my plan. This is what I've done. It's all documented. Thanks very much.
Yeah.
Depends where you are in your journey.
And it also depends the size of the company
Absolutely.
As well.
Yeah. So that's one way. One breach is the obvious one.
Mm-hmm.
You've either lost it or you've got something on your screen that says ransomware.
Yeah.
The one that you don't know about is how often your data has been taken unbeknownst to you, and you can't see what that looks like in terms of finding out if you've been breached.
Okay.
So again, it comes back to tools and access patterns. So there are things you can put in place that go on the dark web and look for your domain name. They look for emails in your business. It will come up and say, here you go. This is where you're being used. Here's unusual activity where, why would somebody be trying to constantly access a particular part of your business from the Ukraine or Siberia or out of Mongolia or wherever it is, because you don't do business there.
Yeah.
That's unusual activity.
The one that I see, obviously, a lot more than IT. Obviously, I need a computer to make websites.
Yeah.
But we don't do IT. They're two very different things. But one thing that I see very regularly is people saying, well, lots of people are commenting on my blog or my website, or people are trying to log into my website. And we put pieces of software and plugins on to just double check with where these people are coming from. But we don't need to update the website, do we?
Yes, obviously. Patching, isn't it? Updating and patching, security patching is how you keep that in.
So that's also another kind of breach, isn't it?
It is, and I think patching is a dark art in terms of how that's done and what people's view is on it, because how breaches come in with people getting onto systems is because code is written by people and designed by people, mm-hmm. and they make mistakes in the code. It happens in everything. Mm-hmm. And what people are doing in terms of trying to be hacking into a system, let's use the hack word, they're looking for mistakes in that code, and that allows them to get into a system.
Mm-hmm.
And what patches do is when they find that hole, they put a patch in like a plaster to plug that, yep. so it blocks it. So on your phone, with your phone updates, any apps that you've got updates, that's what those updates are for. They are security patches to keep you clean and to keep you safe. You get them on a website, you get them on a phone, you certainly get them on your servers, and you get them on your laptops.
And desktops everywhere. And
So when you go Windows update, you think, oh, I need to go.
Just do it.
You just left it. What you just basically said is, I'm not bothered if somebody tries to get into my machine and they get on there.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there might be stuff on your machine now already. And they're using your machine as part of a bigger botnet, and they use lots of different machines
yep.
to do an attack on a system. So they might do a denial of service attack on a website and bring a website down
yep.
for whatever reason they want to do that.
In the past, yep.
So, and you don't know that your machine's being involved in that. Other things are, they'll go onto the network and they'll sit on your machine and they start looking at your activities. And what they're trying to find out really is who your financial people are and your payments that are going out. Once they've got enough information, they can create an attack and go, right, so what we're going to do is we're going to send this type of worded email, because that's what this person, how they sign off, to that person mm-hmm. and ask them to sign some money off.
That happens a lot.
And that might be sat on your machine right now. Just sat there, you've got no idea because nothing's happened to your machine mm-hmm. and you don't know that that's there. So there's all kinds of things that go on. And there's something like, in the end of the 90s, there was something like 15,000 pieces of malware over a whole period of a year. And now it's 100,000 a day.
A day, yeah.
That is the size of it.
There is a website, I can't remember what the name of it is off the top of my head, but there's a website that tells you how many cyber attacks happens by minute.
Oh, it's frightening.
Yeah.
It's absolutely frightening.
It is.
But it's big business. I don't have to go into my post office with a balaclava and a sawn-off shotgun.
Not anymore. No.
I can send a request for smaller amounts of money to people where I become a nuisance mm-hmm. to them and they can't operate
and
don't pay.
This has happened, you know, within my network. I found out that there was a company. I don't know who the company is, but there was a company who didn't update their server, just sat in the corner of a room.
Mm-hmm.
They never looked at it. Didn't think that they needed malware and mm-hmm. Antivirus and all that kind of stuff. The ransomware
yeah.
happened and it was clocking up by the minute.
Mm.
And the IT company that went in to help this company, mm. they were there for 16 days
mm.
to try and, because the data wasn't encrypted.
Yeah.
I don't know what kind of company it is, but they said the data that was there was very personal data.
Mm.
And because it wasn't encrypted, they couldn't, you know, part of it was being taken and trying to get it back. 18 days. I wouldn't even want to fathom how much that would cost for an 18 days full-on IT company to come in and fix that server that was sat in the middle of that room. So, you know, when any time, when your web designer says you need updates, when your IT company says you need updates and your computer says, or your phone says you need to update, just do the update.
Yeah, and I think when people know what the updates are for, they're quite happy to do them. It's just when you think it's an inconvenience. You're so used to seeing it, you think, well, what's ever happened?
Mm.
And the problem with breaches is people think, why me? Why would anybody want to come and get my data? Well, there's not just your data, is it? They want to use your machine. They mm-hmm. want to make you pay $3,000, $2,000, small amounts of Bitcoin. Mm-hmm. And the big places for Bitcoin, they have customer services. So you can ring up and they'll say, yeah, how can I help you buy Bitcoins?
Yeah.
It's a business. It's a multi-million pound business hacking. And that's the thing. It's not why you, it's when you.
When you, definitely.
Oh, definitely when
and
you.
And I think the message that I took from that instance that I just mentioned was, don't think that antivirus and malware stuff is a cost. It's an investment to the business.
It is an investment.
And don't go cheap, whatever you do.
And it's not expensive. Antivirus, it's not expensive. Firewalls these days, you know, you get absolutely top-grade firewall. They're not expensive, and they last for years.
Mm-hmm.
But they're not the only... Once you got them in, that isn't it.
Yeah.
Because your people, where people say, oh, they're a liability, they are your first line of defence. If you... all the people who we deal with who've had problems or breaches, or they ring us up out of the blue and say, but this has happened, can you help us? No one's ever intentionally gone out the way to do it, and they're always mortified.
Yeah.
And the more you empower people to understand the anatomy of an attack, how it can happen, why it happens, how they fit into it, or places where you can go every day that is riddled with malware that people are using all the time, it's going onto the machines. Once you understand that, they're far more comfortable and empowered to be able to go, oh, I'll just give a little second before I open that.
Yeah.
I've got a couple of things I can do to test whether that's genuine or not. And if I'm not sure, I'm going to speak to this person in my business because that's where we go to do this, and they could go and ask somebody else.
Yeah.
It's that taking a second and just
being without, aware.
Yeah, being aware, because otherwise you just click, 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 that looks familiar. And some of them are so good, aren't they? Some of these emails that come through are absolutely mustard. And if I didn't do this job and I don't see it every day, I would probably click on them myself, because they look so genuine.
Yes, they do. Yeah, they do.
You know, you're not a fool if you click on malware, and you shouldn't be afraid to admit that you've done it, because they are so sophisticated now. Mm. But if you're aware that that could happen to you and you take a second or two, you can save yourself a lot of heartache and obviously quite a lot of money.
Yeah. We also touched today on cybersecurity. Mm. Now, cybersecurity is a massive thing. I went to one of the chamber events last week, and I met an insurance guy, business insurance, who talked and said, does your business insurance have cybersecurity? Mm-hmm. And I said, probably not, because this is a new thing, and obviously GDPR. Yeah. And he's like, right, well, we can have a chat. So I'm going to be speaking to him, obviously, before 25th of May. And so cybersecurity, can you just explain that for people? Because some people don't understand what that is. Is that about malware, antiviruses, firewalls? Or is that something different?
Cybersecurity it covers different areas of your business. So in terms of things like an insurance policy, they're looking at what you have in place physically. Do you have a firewall that's up to date? Who checks it's up to date? Is your antivirus up to date? Who checks it's up to date? Have you got security on your email? Do you have a filtering system? You know, it'll be like you do with your normal house insurance. Have you got an alarm on it? You know, are your business cars alarmed? Have you got a tracker on them? It's that kind of thing. Yeah. But the rest of cybersecurity awareness is people training, is understanding what's out there and how it works and how you can be vulnerable and making sure that you're educated. Mm-hmm. So cybersecurity is a big hat to wear, and it covers all those areas. But in terms of GDPR, there's no badge you can say that I am a GDPR expert.
No.
So people are obviously flogging that
at the
minute.
They are indeed.
Ring here, and I just laugh at them. £4,000 for half a day. Yeah, thanks. But there is something the government have brought out as a standard, which is a Cyber Essentials.
Okay.
And the Cyber Essentials certificate is that you are up to a certain standard on things like that your firewall's compliant. Mm-hmm. There are five or six areas that a business complies to that says, that is the standard. It's the bare minimum you should do, and if you've done that, you're taking a big step forward in being compliant. And you get a little certificate, it's a little square with a tick in it. If you were going to tender for business with the MOD or the NHS or the government, if you haven't got Cyber Essentials, you don't even get through the first section. No. Because they're
so that's
trying
just
to
on
put,
the Gov website.
Yeah, they're trying to put a level playing field in for a minimum standard. Certifications, five bodies can certify it. They're all around £295-300 if your certificate. There's some work you need to do to pass the assessment. Mm-hmm. The assessment's online. You can go on the Cybersecurity Essentials Government website and download the assessment and have a look at it. And if you've got an IT person on site, they'll probably be able to fill it out, and you'll be able to get through that yourself. Or you might have to get a company in like us to help you get through there, because you can't answer the questions or you need to put things in place.
Yeah.
Once you've done that and you've passed it once, every year you do it annually, you fill out the form again and away you go. And that's the only thing you can really say at the minute that people would recognise as you've done something about it, and people can do business with you because you've got a minimum level of security. You've proved it with a certificate.
Right.
That's probably about all that you can say, that you can wave a flag to say, I've gone through all this pain.
Yeah, I've got something at the end of the journey.
It's not a long journey, and it's not cumbersome, it's not massively expensive.
No.
So even if you're a small business, you don't have to spend a fortune to get yourself compliant. Mm-hmm. At least you know then that you are done.
Brilliant. I like that. One question that I was going to ask you about the technology that we can use within the business, but I think obviously this depends on the size of the company, you know, the type of company that we run, and the kind of technology that we all use, because there's hundreds of different CRMs, there's different email systems.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that question, we've covered a lot actually anyway with regards to technology. So I wanted to ask you when we come to the point of having to destroy data, let's say, we get all this data that we have, we're putting it into our recycle bin.
Mm-hmm.
Is that good enough to just put in our recycle bin and click delete? Or is there a way in which we have to destroy data?
You would need to, depending on what software you've got, I would always say, speak to software people and ask them the best practice to delete the data with whatever you use them, whether it's your CRM, whether it's your email. You know, you can go into Office 365, you can go to Microsoft and you can dig out the best way to delete, you know, what their recycle bin clearing out rules are, mm-hmm. how long it is before they've deleted it. There are some systems where you can click delete and it's still in there.
Yeah.
Same with your backups. You know, if you've got backups that are on a rolling 31-day detention, you know, it'll still be in your backup until it's dropped off the end. So you need to understand what your systems you're using and go to the source of the system to be absolutely sure about what you're dealing with.
Yeah.
In terms of removing hardware from a business that's got hard drives in, whether it's a laptop or it's a server, there are hundreds of businesses out there who will take that away and give you certificates mm-hmm. of destruction. Some of them will do it for nothing because they repurpose the machines at the end of it. They might charge you for the certificate. If you get a Banco certificate, which is like the top notch, the 5-10 quid-ish for a hard drive, not massively expensive. If you were deleting a lot of them, you'd probably be able to do yourself a deal anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So you can go onto yell.com and type in recycling companies and there will be people who will be able to come and pick the stuff up for you, recycle it and give you a certificate. Then you can prove that if something happened and data came about and you said, well, I've destroyed that, you've got your certificate that says, this was done by me with this company.
Yeah.
Here's my certificate that says it's been destroyed along the guidelines.
Yeah.
Of the destruction industry, which is, you know, the different levels of company that will do it, mm-hmm. different levels of certification. You've got no comeback then, have you? You've done the right thing.
Yes. Yeah.
If you throw it in your bin or you take a hammer to it, no.
you can't just put a nail through it anymore.
No. Even though you might think, well, he's going to be able to look at that, you don't know what he's going to get hold of it. Yeah. And there's big business to be had in doing things like that. So yeah, I would say for the sake of a tenner, Get it properly.
We also talked about backing up, mm-hmm. And you've just touched on, you know, the 31-day rolling detention.
Mm-hmm.
With backup systems mm-hmm. or cloud systems.
Mm-hmm.
How often should people back up? Because I know people who don't back up, and I'm like, it gives me anxiety thinking, if you don't back up, where is your stuff?
Yeah.
You know, what happens if that laptop or whatever's lost, you know?
So we'd say the golden rule is to have 3 different copies of your data
on
two different formats and one of them in the cloud.
Yep.
So you might have your data on a server. You'll have that backed up to an on-site device where you can do recoveries, local recoveries, and that will go off-site to a cloud version that you can access should your business be down or you're not able to access
mm-hmm.
your data on the server for whatever reason. When people say disaster recovery, I think hurricanes, fires and flood, it's mainly going to be
somebody's breaking
somewhere.
In. Or somebody's broken into the...
It could be that. It could be somebody's disgruntled, spills a cup of tea and it takes a hammer to it. But normally it's because you've got a virus that's encrypted the whole of your business and you need to go and roll back to work on a version of your business that happened before the ransomware and hopefully hours before, not days and weeks before.
Yeah.
So that is why we would say that backing up regularly is absolutely key. So the systems, we have some customers who back up every 5 minutes. We have customers who replicate their business to another infrastructure constantly live because they're in the NHS or the medical or websites. They have to be completely up, financial companies, 100% uptime, like your bank, like the TSB.
Mm-hmm.
You won't want to be down.
Well, as a web company, when I first started my business 12 years ago, one of the things that I was reading about is that in your insurance, you have to back up minimum every day.
Mm.
And I know that there's a lot of companies out there that don't back anything.
And that's why I would say the difference between backup and recovery. You can back it up and that's great, you've got a copy of it, but what are you going to do with that? Where's it going? Now, in the olden days, there used to be vans that turn up with servers in there, racks of servers you could hire, and you'd put your software on there and you'd rebuild the databases. Mm. But that could take you, two or 3 days just to rebuild the databases. Yeah. And all that time, your business is down.
Yeah. Not so
nowadays,
any money. Yeah.
Well, exactly. So nowadays, I talk about recovery in seconds
mm-hmm.
and minutes
mm-hmm.
rather than days and weeks.
Okay.
So
and there's lots of software out there.
Loads
that you can
of different software you can use. Some of it is backup only, mm-hmm. and some of it's business continuity. And business owners need to understand the difference. And you need to do a regular test. All our customers, we do a lot of backup and business continuity, and we have built into their monthly payments is regular disaster recovery testing, so they know exactly how long they will be down for and how much data they would lose in the event of there being an issue. Some of them back up every 5 minutes, some of them back up every hour. And they have backup systems whereby if they get ransomware, they can roll back an hour. Yeah. They don't have to pay the fine. They wipe it off the system or we do it for them. Mm-hmm. It's a managed service. And they carry on regardless.
Perfect.
So there's, it depends, like I said, business size, how much money you've got to spend. It doesn't have to be expensive backup, but it is. It does have to be in place. And you do have to understand how long you're going to be down for. A lot of compliance, ISO 9001, there's a section in there now for your business continuity, mm-hmm. what you're doing about it. A lot of our customers in logistics and manufacturing and warehousing, they have to, if they're delivering to Sainsbury's or Asda or Marks and Spencer's, they have to have that as part of their compliance. They have to have an RTO and an RPO, which is the return to operation time, mm-hmm. and how much data they'd lose. It has to be written in. And if it's longer than a particular time, they'll say, I'm really sorry, but we're not dealing with you anymore. You're out because yeah. you're not compliant. And if you fail and you are down, you get fined, and we're talking hundreds of thousands of pounds yeah. worth of fines. Yeah.
Oh, gosh.
So if you're a smaller business, it's all relative to what you do for a living. You can't afford to be down.
No, you can't.
So if your email's hosted somewhere and your email's operational and you can invoice, you can normally get through a few days, mm-hmm. can't you, if mm-hmm. you're a smaller business. If you're making widgets or you're selling cheeses or you're making whatever you're doing and you're doing it 24/7, you can't be down at all because you're not going to hit your quotas. But if you're somewhere in the middle, like a solicitor's or an accountant's or a professional services, mm-hmm. you can normally manage by losing half a day. So if you did have an issue, you had to get up and running and do something about it, and you had a reasonable disaster recovery plan, you probably would be fine as long as your business email was up and running and your email isn't sat with everything else. So there's things like that as a business you need to think about in terms of what am I doing? How does it work? Mm-hmm. How does it integrate? What happens when that goes down? Not if, what happens when that's affected?
Yeah.
What do I do?
Well.
And that's data by design.
Yeah. We've covered a lot.
We have.
We've covered a
lot. I'm shattered.
Yeah. So, my final question really is, just going back to the beginning, where should people start? People who are listening to this today, mm-hmm. where should they start? Obviously, they should ideally have started by now, but if they haven't, you know, we've still got until the 25th of May 2018. Mm-hmm. The first thing I think we talked about is doing the audit, finding out where that data is and the mm-hmm. software that you can do to find out permissions and all of that kind of mm-hmm. stuff on various different devices, whether it's a laptop, phone, desktop, server, mm-hmm. whatever. And once you've done that, you then need to work out what kind of data you've got.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And once you've worked out what kind of data you've got, you've then, from what I can tell from what we've talked about today, you've got to work out the policies.
You have. You need to think about what you want to do with that data and how you're going to design your policies around your HR, your marketing and your protection of your data. That's all governed by the policy. I would suggest everybody has a look at the ICO Commission website mm-hmm. because they are the deliverers of this. They are managing it. They are the governance place. There are a lot of scaremongering and misinformation going on with GDPR.
Yes, there is. Yeah.
But that website is, they are running the show, and what's on their website is where they're up to at the moment, mm-hmm. and it changes regularly. So if you weren't sure, you were just starting out, I would go on there. There's absolutely loads of hints and tips
and
information that you can go on and calm yourself down. Mm. So
you could even, there is actually a call line.
There is.
Specific for small business. There's one for larger businesses.
Yeah, there is.
And there's different sections as well for smaller businesses, larger businesses. Yeah. So there's no excuse, is there?
No, and you get straight from the horse's mouth, and they will give you, we got the 12 steps on there. Mm-hmm. On a nice big bright yellow poster you can take and stick on your wall. And if you work through those, you'll be doing the right thing.
The best you can.
Yeah, in whatever order you need to do them.
Yeah.
It doesn't really matter, because one thing might be easier for you to do than another, but at least you've started. Not starting is the worst thing to do.
Yes.
Making a plan to do something about it that you might get round to is not the same as implementing it. You need to make a start with something. And do something that you know that you're comfortable with to start off with if you're very nervous about mm-hmm. it, but start something and use the ICO as your guide, not your mate down the pub or someone at a networking meeting, you get this massive fine. You need to understand where you fit into the processes and you need to make a decision on what you're going to do first.
And speak to your people. You know, if you've got an accountant, if you've got a...
Absolutely.
Which everybody will have. Accountant, IT person, marketing person, web person. All of these different people. Speak to them. Find out what they know. Because they've got to do it for their other customers
anyway.
Exactly.
And we'll be amazed if most of our businesses haven't had somebody come to them and say, can you fill this for us? We need to contact you. Do you give us permission? All of that is them fulfilling their GDPR.
Yeah. So we've got those people at our beck and call, really. You know, they are our suppliers. Yeah.
And you might find that we do with our customers, we say to them, go back to the people who are delivering those services. They might be able to do a lot of this as part of your contract. Mm-hmm. They might already know a lot of this stuff already that they can give to you just to get you going. You don't have to do it all on your own with a crash helmet on going, my goodness me, I don't even know where to start, because they're doing this, like you say, for everybody. Unless it's the good thing about GDPR, it is for everybody. We all have to comply.
Yeah.
Everybody, even the people who are nuisance calling us or spamming us, you know, they need to comply to that. Mm-hmm. And you might still get spammed if you've got a business address or an info out of a sales app, because that's still okay. But if it's your own personal email address and you're getting spammed or they're ringing you at home, then you've got every right to say, where did you get my data from?
Of course you have. Mm-hmm. Okay. So is there anything else, Samantha?
No, I
that we haven't
really
covered. To be fair, we're 49 minutes in, and I think we've covered a lot.
I think we really have, and I think the main thing is to understand what you're doing, get a plan, get other people in your business involved, so it's not just a single person, and it's a top-down thing. It's got to come from the top down, what you're doing, why you're doing it. Your people need to be involved in the journey of understanding where they fit into it, so that they do comply. And you, if you need support, there's plenty of people you can speak to out there. There's businesses like me, businesses like you, businesses like the lady spoke to last week on the HR. There's plenty of help and support out there, because we're doing this for everybody. You won't be the only person who's not done anything if you haven't done anything. You won't be the only person who's got halfway down there. You might be in the small minority of people who've absolutely nailed it by now.
But that would be the larger, have. I think.
The bigger, the bigger people companies. Are heavily compliant already, like medical, financial, businesses like that, banking, they're all way ahead of it. But normal, in inverted commas, businesses like us see it as a burden. It's a massive time sealer. They're really busy. They don't know where to start. They keep putting it off. They hear all these different rumours and stories and scaremongering. It's like, what's it all about? Yeah. So really, go on the website, have a look. Speak to the people that you're dealing with who are your third parties, because they will have all this nailed, or they should have, and just start.
Yeah.
Just do something.
Get it done. Brilliant. So how can people contact you if they wanted to speak to you about their IT?
So they can go on our website at keytech.co.uk and find our contact details there. Yep. We've got a Twitter feed for KeyTech. We've got a Facebook page. We've got LinkedIn. You can ring me if you want to on the KeyTech telephone number.
Okay.
01942 311151, and ask for Samantha, and we're more than happy to give you some advice or help you get involved with some of the tools that you might need to access, or the cyber training, or just have a cup of tea and a biscuit and understand what you need to do.
Perfect. I really appreciate you taking the time to do this podcast with me.
Thank you very much.
So thanks again, and I believe that we've got some homework to do.
I think you might have.
Thanks again.
Thanks.
Cheers.
You're listening to Integrate to Influence.
Okay, so I hope you found this podcast useful. It's a really long podcast. There's going to be lots for you to think about and lots for you to do. If you did find it useful, I'd really appreciate that you leave us a review, share it with somebody that you think that would benefit from listening to this podcast, download it so you can listen to it again later, and just share the love. I really appreciate you listening and hope to see you again soon.
Thank you for listening to the Integrate to Influence podcast at www.integratedmarketingpodcast.com, brought to you by Cougar.